Like I said, and it's being recorded, okay? We'll do a roll call, Diana. Diana, you're muted.
Councilmember Edvig?
Here.
Councilmember Bauer? Councilmember Neubauer?
Here.
Councilmember Robinson?
Here.
And Mayor Feldman?
Here. Okay. Do I have a motion tonight to adopt tonight's agenda? Do I have a motion?
I'll make that motion, Mayor.
All right. Councilor Robinson makes that motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Councilor Neubauer makes a second. Any discussion? If not, Diana, do a roll call, please.
Councilmember Udvig?
Aye.
Councilmember Bauer? Councilmember Neubauer?
Aye.
Councilmember Robinson?
Aye.
Mayor Feldman?
Aye. Okay. Moving on tonight, the consent agenda. I'm going to pull out item B just for clarification. So I have a motion tonight to adopt tonight's consent agenda items A, C, D, and E. Do I have a motion?
I'll make that motion, Mr. Mayor.
Councilor Udvig makes that motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second again.
Councilor Neubauer makes a second. Any discussion? If not, Diana, do a roll call, please.
Councilmember Udvig?
Aye.
Councilmember Neubauer?
Aye.
Councilmember Robinson?
Aye.
Mayor Feldman?
Aye. Okay. Item B, the question I have on this, because if you look at the packet, council members, on page, it shows on page 15 a map, and as Diana explained to me, there's an X where he's been. Now, does he want to go in the neighborhoods to solicit this food truck? Usually we've had them at Community Park, we've had them at the Liquor Muni. I'm just not familiar with them being in the neighborhoods with the food truck. So Diana, is that what he's requesting?
He wanted to leave it open. He's had a number of residents contact him for the possibility of having him in the neighborhood. He does not have anything on the book, but he wanted to obtain his permit so that he had that option.
Okay, so my next question is to Kate. How does that work?
Mayor and Council, so they can go into the neighborhoods. They do have some zoning requirements that we take a look at. They have to have permission from the property owner. So if it's in a street, they have to have permission from the city. If it's in a driveway, it has to have permission from a property owner. But they are eligible to do that. And that's very common in a lot of the cities right now where they're coming into neighborhoods like that.
Okay. All right. I just wanted to bring that to the attention of the city council. So I just want to start with Joe Neubauer. Do you have any questions on this at all, Joe?
No. I mean, I say no harm, no foul. If he wants to do business that way, if they feel that they can do all right, I don't see any issue with that.
Okay. Kevin, your comments?
I'm with Joe. I don't see any problem with it. Again, if the neighborhood is allowing it, and it looks like is the X, Kate, where he wants to park his vehicle? Is that where it would be?
Correct. He's looking at putting it right into the street there.
Okay. And no, if he's crossed the T's and dot the I's and hasn't infringed on any of our policies or ordinances, I'm okay with it. Interesting experiment, say the least.
Yeah, it's just something I wasn't familiar with. Sherry, any comment from you? Okay. All right. We did forget the Pledge of Allegiance because I don't see it on the agenda, but we will do that right after this one here. Okay. So do I have a motion to adopt the consent agenda item B, peddler's license? Do I have a motion? Anybody?
I'll make it, Mayor.
Councilor Robinson makes that motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Councilor Erdogan makes a second. Any further discussion? If not, Diana, do a roll call, please.
Councilmember Udvig?
Aye.
Aye. Councilmember Neubauer?
Aye.
Councilmember Robinson?
Aye.
Mayor Feldman?
Aye. All right, thank you. Thank you for the clarification, Diana and Kate. All right, before we go on, we'll do a Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. All right, for the next time, we'll have that on the agenda because I don't see it on here. So we'll make sure we put that on after we call to order. Okay, moving on to a meeting open to the public. Joe, do we have anyone?
I do not see anyone here that is not part of our team tonight.
Okay. Okay. So in that case, we'll move on to new business. Item 9A, City Hall Security.
Honorable Mayor, members of the council, in front of you tonight is the topic we discussed at the work session last Tuesday. Just as a refresher, we kind of ended in a 2-2, two in favor, kind of two probably unsure about doing this project. So the consensus was that we'd bring it back tonight for a vote because we anticipated having all here. That is not the case. So I will turn it over to the mayor if he wants to present any more additional facts, and I can certainly answer any questions as well.
Okay. Well, first of all, we already know Rob's take on this, which is a no, not a nay vote. So we'll leave that in the public format. All right. First of all, the bid for the construction from Weber, I actually had him reduce it down $1,699 from a total that was $18,329. I have it down to $16,630 now. There was some things in there that just weren't necessary, so I had to deduct it. So that was basically, again, a $1,699 savings. As I mentioned to council before at the work session, we had originally planned to replace three HVAC units in the city hall, but instead we did an efficiency test on those three furnaces and found out they were highly efficiently still in good working order. So we did not spend that $22,000. So I'm asking to reallocate that money towards this change. And we also have, each year since we came in, we've been putting money aside for maintenance to the buildings, and we have a total of $320,384 set aside for the buildings that we've been under maintenance since we came in. As it turns out, I'm trying to get a FOB bid on the doors. I have not been able successfully to do that because the vendor that we've had seems to be proprietary. And we're not sure what we can do as far as going with that system, or can we break from that system? We have a year contract left, as Jason has told me earlier. So we're still dealing with that. So all I can do right now is go by the actual number we have from the vendor we have dealt with for the fire station on the bid that he has, which I think is high, by the way, which is $16,874.35 for five doors. I don't believe it should be that high, but I can only go by that bid right now. I have another subcontractor looking at it, and we'll get us numbers in the next few days, and I can come back to council with that. So at the worst case scenario, this job would cost us $33,504.35, or 10.4566% of the total of $320,384, 10.4566%. So on this, I know what I've heard from some of a couple of council members that were against this. I can just say to you that, you know, after going through what I've done so far and Jason's done so far in Parrish and that, and we have done with the construction of the Liquor Muni and how long it took to get to that point, we will take a long time to discuss the City Hall Fire Station. And I have no doubt about that. And we should take the time so that we do it properly. So my guess would be we'll be in this building that we're in 2 to 3 years, if not longer. And I think security is an issue. It's amazing to me that we have security at the fire station, we have security at the police public works building, but we have no security in our city hall. I think that's a mistake here. Do I want to spend any more money in the city hall? Of course I don't. And if it was a $300,000 bill, I would say no. If it was the fact that we were moving out in the next 6 months to a year, I'd probably say maybe not. I would be questionable about that one on the sidelines a little bit more, but we're not going to be out of that building in the next year or two, I'm sure of it. So I just think that it's the right thing to do here. I'd rather be safe than sorry here. And I think it's something we need to do here. We've had some concerns by a couple of our members and the staff about the security issues there. And like I say, again, I don't think it's not something we can sit here and take a chance on. Again, it's basically an insurance policy to keep our people safe. And I think that's important. Let me get off this volume here on my phone here. So I would just say to you that I think we should move forward with this. I wouldn't plan on doing this till August, by the way, so I have time to get the FOB bid in place. I want to try this out with Weber Construction so that when the framers are over framing the Liquor Muni, they'll come over and frame this, because I advise them we shut down for 10 days and get this done efficiently and quickly. So I want to work to the schedule of what their subs are over there to cross the street and come over and do ours. So, but I think it's something, again, you want to be safe than sorry. And I think it's money well spent. We have the money. It's not as though we don't, and it's something we should do. Again, I don't understand why we are cautious with the fire, cautious with Police Public Works, but not our city administration. On that, I'm going to turn over some conversation here, and I'll start with Kevin on your take on this.
Well, Mayor, I'd like to pass and go right to Sarah because she was not at the work session to get her take on it. I have formulated some ideas, but I'd like to hear hers as well.
Okay, let's do that. Sarah, you're on.
I'm in favor of it. I think that, nowadays safety is very important. mental health issues are on the rise. Crimes are on the rise. And I myself would feel terrible if I said, we have money set aside for, HVAC, but we can't seem to have money to protect our workers. And I'd feel horrible if something happened to them and it was a matter of us just going, we're going to move out of the building in a couple of years. What if that doesn't happen? What if between now and when we move out, something actually happens, whether it's at the city hall itself or it's across the street at Quick Trip? What if something happens? The fact that our staff is not secure in their building does not sit well with me. I just spoke up to the school board about their lack of the security measures that they promised were going to happen with this bond money, and then it didn't happen. And so I think we owe it to our staff. I really do. I think that, we're asking them to, help run our city. And if we can't in turn give them the protection that they feel they need and are comfortable with, they should be able to lock the doors from behind the desk. They should have a button that they could push, a panic button that they could push to notify that something's going on. They should have something to protect them from something, for someone jumping over a counter at them or breaking down a door because we don't know. Nothing's happened yet. But I want to make sure that in the event something does happen, we're ready for it.
Thank you, Sarah. Kevin, yours take now.
It seems like a lot of money right now, but again, over a 5-year, maybe a 40-year period, it'll break down to X amount of dollars per year. I also like the fact that during our work session, the chief of police was also asked, he's going to do some instructional education with the staff as well, as far as similar to what schools do, lockdown situation, procedurals, things to keep everybody safe and retreat accordingly, et cetera. So he's also reviewed what construction plans are proposed, and then along with your construction background, Mayor. No, I don't like spending the extra money either, but if somebody was putting cars through the building, we'd pay for balusters to be in front of it. Like Sarah said, these are odd times. Some of the oddities and people are coming out now and things are just different. If it was our regular building, we'd be making changes to it. If it was something that we'd already built, we'd be making some additions to it. I know other members feel that we're leaving this building behind at some point, but it's the some point that is bothering me from not, I think we should do what's right now. And again, protect the staff as best we can. And if we hadn't done it, you can always look over your shoulder. 35 grand is a lot of money, but when you put a price tag on what this can prevent or potentially prevent is, to me, it's well worth it. So that's my take.
All right, thank you, Kevin. Joe, your comments?
Well, I want to look terrible here, but it is what it is. As much as I care about our staff and I think that they should be safe, I just don't see putting the money into this building. I think we take this moment to, one, commend the police for doing a good job and keeping everybody safe during that incident at Quick Trip. And then also, if we plan for the future for the building that we're looking into moving forward into, we can put that money towards that. That's just my opinion.
Okay, let me just go back here and say that, we may end up, we're planning to build a City Hall fire station in the next 3 to 5 years. We don't know what the economy is going to be at that time. we may have the plans designed and ready to go, but the economy may falter and we may have to hold on those plans. So this building could be here two, three years in the planning stage, could be here 5 years or more in that stage. I'm not willing to take the risk that our people aren't safe when we have safety for our fire departments and we have safety again for our public police public works building, but not our administration building. I can't take a chance on that. I don't want to look our staff in the face and say we could have done better had we not been so tight with the money. We have the money. As I said before, a water heater is not a problem if you have the money to replace it. It becomes a burden, but not a problem. It's only a problem and a burden when you don't have the money to replace it. We have the money here and we should allocate it. It's $33,504 on the high side. I will try to get that FOBS bid down, or I will cancel some of the doors in the back or whatever and reroute it that way. But I want to make it as secure as possible. An issue has been brought up to us by members of our staff, no different than any issue brought up to us by a resident that concerns them in our city. And we listen to that. We need to listen to this. And again, I've talked to some of our staff. I talked to our community development director, our city administrator. I've talked to our chief of police that you heard. I think it's the right thing to do. Sometimes you just have to do the right thing. And this is one of those right things. So we already know that Rob's vote is a nay vote. Let's Sarah talk in a second here. We already know Joe's a nay. And Sarah, your comments?
Just for a comparison, if we don't want to do the upgrades to the building, Todd, could you give us an estimate of what it would cost to have security at the building instead? I mean, that's another route to go. If we're not going to upgrade the building, then the least we can do is give them security. So how much would it cost to give them security at the building?
Well, I guess that would depend on how it would be broken down. I mean, the school resource officer contract, if we want to compare it to that, you know, 8 hours a day for, again, the school year was 171 days, and that was about $74,000. So you can maybe do the math, I guess, above and beyond, you know, add an additional 3 months to that.
Right.
Would be okay. The cost of an officer.
So it would be more than what the cost would be to put into the building.
Right, and that's a good point, and I'm glad you brought that up. And also, by the way, you know, I brought up at the work session about how this FOB system we're talking about will be taken to the new building too, by the way. I'm gonna suggest that, as I said at the work session, I wanna salvage everything, scavenge everything we can out of that building before we leave it. I mean, I would take the air conditioners and the furnaces if they were brand new. I'll take the thermostats if I can get away with that. I'll take anything out of there as long as it's our building to work in our new building. I have no problem with that whatsoever, and they can buy it as is. But in that particular point, we'll have to wait and see. My only concern is this, is that, again, issues, concern has been brought to us by a couple of our staff, and we don't, as Kevin alluded to, we don't know what time frame we're talking about building a new City Hall fire station. It could be many years, it could be faster. I still don't think it's going to happen within minimum of two, possibly three, before we see a shovel, a plan that we all agree on, and then shovels in the ground in that latter part of the 3 years or into the fourth year. So you're talking about 2025 before we see something like that, and that means we're still in this building. So we should be safe. It should be, when it's only, you know, right now the high number said of the 10.54566% of it, of the money we have in place, we should do something. If we didn't have the money, that'd be different. If we had to raise taxes to do it, that'd be different, but we don't. We have the money. We're running the city with strong budgetary management, and we have the ability to do this, and we should. So any other comments by council on this before we move for a motion and a vote? None? Okay. So do I have a motion to approve the City Hall security remodeling? Hopefully in the month of August, we'll try to set for that time for a time frame, but do I have a motion to approve the City Hall remodeling for security?
I'll make that motion, Mayor.
Councilor Robinson makes that motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second, Mr. Mayor.
Councilor Udovic makes a second. Any further conversation? If not, Diana, do a roll call, please.
Councilmember Udvig?
Aye.
Councilmember Robinson?
Aye.
Councilmember Muehlbauer?
Aye.
Mayor Feldman?
Aye. And for the record, Councilor Bauer, nay. Motion passes 3-2. Thank you. I will let council know the new change in the FOB bid as soon as I get it, and we can go from there. But it will not be higher than the present one we have. All right, thank you so much for that. Moving on to item 9, new business. Item B, ordinance 281, second series, adding chapter 6, bed and breakfast facility license, second reading. Ordinance 281, second series, number 2, resolution 2021XX, authorizing summary publication. Kate, or Beth, rather.
Mayor and Council, that's me. So before you tonight is a second reading for the bed and breakfast facility licensing. This is an update as we added it as a new permitted use in zoning. So this will create the business licensing that keeps these businesses in a condition that are safe and healthy in our community and for those that are renting them out. As this is a second reading, we would have the summary publication as well. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Okay, well, I have no questions on this. I think this is really good because what I like about this most is the purpose of these types of licenses are to ensure the property is safe, meeting all health and lodging requirements, and is in the proper zoning district. I think that's all good stuff there. So I'm all in favor of this myself. So Joe, I'll turn it over to you for a conversation.
Yeah, I don't have anything to add, Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
All right. Sarah, your comments?
No, I think we've discussed this enough in other meetings and such, and I'm fine with it.
Okay, Kevin?
No, Mayor, I have nothing to add either, thank you.
Okay, so let's see. Dave, do I have to do this in two separate motions? Okay.
So one's an ordinance and the other one's a resolution.
Okay. So do I have a motion tonight for ordinance 281, second series, adding chapter 6, bed and breakfast facility license, second reading. Do I have a motion to adopt ordinance 281, second series? Do I have a motion?
I'll make that motion, Mr. Mayor.
All right, Councilmember Hubauer makes that motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Okay, Councilmember Udvik makes a second. Barring any further discussion, Diana, do a roll call, please.
Councilmember Udvik?
Aye.
Councilmember Mühlbauer?
Aye.
Councilmember Robinson?
Aye.
Mayor Feldman?
Aye. And also, Rob Bauer, Councilmember Bauer's present.
We can note in the minutes that Councilmember Bauer joined the meeting at 6:22 p.m.
Okay, so let's get a vote from him on this. Rob?
Councilmember Bauer?
I'll abstain from this vote.
Okay, we'll go. So we have it 4-0. Okay. Moving on to resolution 2021XX, authorizing summary publication. Do I have a motion?
Make that motion, Mayor.
Councilor Robinson makes that motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
All right, Councilor Mühlbauer makes a second. Any discussion? If not, Diana, do a roll call, please.
Councilmember Udvig?
Aye.
Councilmember Bauer?
Aye.
Councilmember Mühlbauer?
Aye.
Councilmember Robinson?
Aye.
Mayor Feldman?
Aye. Okay, motion passes. All right, moving on to new business item C, 9C, River's Edge final plat approval. Resolution 2021XX, a resolution approving final plat and plats for the fifth edition of River's Edge. And item 2, approval of development agreement for the fifth edition. Beth, I believe that's you.
Yep, Mr. Mayor, thank you. Let me just pull up the presentation here. There we go. Mayor and Council, before you tonight are the final plat and plans for the fifth edition of the River's Edge subdivision. This subdivision is located along Rum River Boulevard, east of the Rum River. And the fifth edition final plat includes 45 lots that are kind of scattered throughout the central area of the subdivision. These lots are a mix of traditional single family and villa lots. So tonight, the applicant is requesting approval of the fifth edition final plat and plans. A draft developer's agreement has also been prepared for your review and approval tonight. Just as a little bit of a background, the overall development for River's Edge was originally brought forward in January of 2018 as a concept. At that point, it included 220 lots over about 90 acres. Since then, the developer has gone through the preliminary platting process and has been slowly platting off different sections of this development. So the first phase preliminary plat was approved in April of 2018. That's the black rectangle on the eastern side there. and as I said, we've been adding additions ever since. So we've had 4 additions for the River's Edge subdivision so far, for a total of 45 lots that are final platted currently. Tonight, council is asked to review the 5th addition. So that's in orange. As you can see, it's kind of spread throughout the development. And the 5th addition will be created from outlot C of the 2nd addition and outlot A of the 4th addition. So as I said, the 5th addition includes 45 lots. It also includes multiple street sections. It does conform to the approved phase 1 and phase 2 preliminary plats for the area. And the final plat creates 3 outlots, A, B, and C. And drainage and utility easements will be established over all 3 of those outlots as part of the final plat. So this is the east side of River's Edge. The east side of the 5th addition includes 19 lots. They are both traditional single family lots and villa style. Marigold Street and 236th Lane will also be extended as part of this plat, and outlots B and C will be created. So outlot B, which is the larger one there, that will be platted into buildable lots in a future addition. And outlot C will remain in perpetuity as an outlot and be used for drainage purposes. And outlot C is right here where my cursor is, if that's helpful. The west side of the 5th addition includes 26 traditional single family lots, 236th Lane, 237th Lane, Undercliff Street, and Quay Street will all be extended as part of this addition. And then this extension will provide roadway access to Sywick Park. That's the park that the city received the grant for and is planned to be developed pretty soon here. Outlot A to the west is created as part of this addition and will be platted into buildable lots as part of a future addition. So staff is recommending approval of the 5th addition final plat and plans, subject to conditions. Staff is also recommending approval of the draft developer's agreement for the 5th addition. I am happy to answer any questions.
Well, I thank you, Beth. It's nice to see this finally getting to a 5th addition. I know it's been a lot of work in the making there from 2018 on, but I think it's a good development. I think the builders are working well with the developer, and I think the developer is working well with the city. So I'm very much for this. I see he's got some river lots in that and sold already and occupied and all that. I think it's been a good plus for our city. And taking advantage of, I think the actual growth spurt came on as far as the pandemic helped out and the safety issues in Minneapolis and all that has brought people more out to our area, and this is a good development. So I'm very much for this. So I'll turn it over for a conversation or comments to Sarah. I'll start with you.
No, I like to see continued growth in the city, and I think we need to move along with this. So I'm fine with it.
All right, thank you. Rob, your comments?
Nope, I don't have any concerns over the addition.
Okay. Kevin, your comments?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mayor. I have 2 of them. One of them, glad to see under the page 58 of 108, the stormwater calculations, there's 4 concerns there that need to be met. And then, as we've talked about other neighborhoods in the past, that long past, not during this administration or so, but drainage issues had arose after people moved in and blames were put on realtors and this and that and whatnot. But as long as these stormwater calcs are met, our engineers' satisfaction and Keith's satisfaction, I'm happy. I also like to know, Beth, maybe you told us earlier on Sywick Park. How did it get its name, or how is it getting its name?
Yes, Mayor and Council, and Kate can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe that is the name of the former property owner of this entire land.
That is correct.
All right, awesome. Thank you. That's all I have, Mayor. Thank you. Thank you, Beth, Kate.
And as Kevin has stated, these calculations will be changed to the recommendations by engineering, I take it. Right?
Mayor and Council, yes. So the city engineer has provided conditions that the applicant will need to meet. So those would those would need to be changed to the engineer's satisfaction.
Okay, good. All right, very good. All right, who did I leave out here? I leave out Joe. Joe, comments from you?
All right, I don't have anything to add. I'm in favor of it. Everything looks good. It's been going good with this developer, so I'm all for it.
Okay, great. All right, then on that, do I have a motion to approve River's Edge final plat approval, resolution 2021XX, a resolution approving the final plat and plats for the fifth edition of River's Edge. Do I have a motion?
I'll make that motion.
Councilor Barber makes that motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Councilor Mewbar makes a second. Any further discussion? If not, Diana, do a roll call, please.
Councilmember Edvig?
Aye.
Councilmember Bauer?
Aye.
Councilmember Mewbauer?
Aye.
Councilmember Robinson?
Aye.
Mayor Feldman?
Aye. All right, thank you. Moving on to item 2C2, do I have a motion to adopt approval of development agreement for the fifth edition? Do I have a motion for that?
I'll make that motion, Mr. Mayor.
Councilor Mewbar makes that motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Councilor Ulrich makes a second. Any further discussion? If not, Diana, do a roll call on this, please.
Councilmember Edvig?
Aye.
Councilmember Bauer?
Aye.
Councilmember Mewbauer?
Aye.
Councilmember Robinson?
Aye.
Mayor Feldman?
Aye. Thank you, Beth, once again, and Kate. It seems like the city's grown in a good way, and this is a good development. I've been out there, and I'm sure the rest of the council has seen it too. It is a good development. All right, moving on to the next item, 9D, GPS locators. Jason?
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, Public Works is looking at replacing a locator that they have. It's roughly 20 years old. It's outdated. We're looking to replace it with a GPS locator all in one. It uses a software called MnCore that is ran by MnDOT and other state agencies that shares the data to get you within, I want to say it's within inches of your what you're trying to locate. So really what we're trying to do is utilize a handheld locator to locate our utilities within our city, both what's in the public right of way and on our private properties that we own. And then along with that is the GPS. So what we can actually do is grid out what we're searching for, whether it be a private gas line on our property, power line, sewer, water, and then what we can do, curb stops as well. And then what we can do is we can upload it to our new GIS system. So it will overlay. The one that we have now is not GPS. So if we want to locate all our curb stops within our city, which we do, that's one of our goals that we want to obtain in the next year and a half. This unit that I'm proposing would be able to do that. If you guys have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them.
Okay, well, thank you, Jason. You know, I talked to Jason earlier, and in the packet, he mentions that since he started here, that we've paid over $2,500 to have locators come out that for the capability that we didn't have. And he just did a third one. If you take it at $1,250 a shot, that's $3,750 that we paid out for three locations where we could have had our own machine do that for us. And I'm a firm believer whenever we can do something that helps, we should be able and capable of doing such. This tool will allow us to do that. And I think it's important. I know it would have helped us on the Liquor Muni site as we try to relocate some of the underground utilities there. So I know it's a piece of equipment that will be used, especially with the curb stops and that we've had issues with not being able to detect them. As he stated in the packet, as you read, that this is the only one that combines everything all in one tool. Where if we went from Grager or the other entity, other vendor, we'd have to combine those two with all over $16,000 to do the same thing. So I know they'll get a lot of use out of it. I think what you're seeing is that the businesses that are locating with tools like this are charging that kind of money to pay for their expense of buying that same tool that we should be having in-house ourselves. So again, we've already spent over $3,750 out of pocket for just three locates. It doesn't make sense that if we have more locates to do that, we should be paying someone else to do what we can do in house. So I'm for this expenditure. I think we'll get a lot of use out of it, just like we have some of the other things like the lift and everything else we purchased for Public Works. It just makes us more independent. And whenever you can bring it in-house and be independent, you're much better off in the long run. So that's my take on it. Joe, I'll turn this over to you for your comments.
Yeah, I was just curious because when you say it's out of date, I get the old one doesn't have GPS, but does the locator, I know how we used to do it with the utility is they'd have a wire run along the pipe. You hook something up to it over by the meter typically, and then it senses the reading off of that. And do we use like USCI or USIC or whatever they are to do the locating before? And I guess I'm just kind of curious, do we have those wires already run and that's how we find them, or how does this work different, I guess, than that?
So a couple questions there. Right now, our ordinance states that any water line, any service line, anything that runs into the city has a tracer wire ran with it.
Okay.
And as Craig would attest to this, when we started running tracer wires with our water lines, they weren't being hooked up right by the contractors. Okay. So we corrected that. And it wasn't just in the city. It was all over the place. We corrected that. So hopefully now everything going in will have a tracer wire with it. And yes, you can take the locator and you can hook right on to the source, whether it be a water meter or a curb stop, and you'll have constant continuity running through it. To the ones that don't have tracer wires, this locator will also allow you to stick a ground rod in and you can change your frequencies. It's like a cone angle, and it will get you more accurate to hone in on it. Accuracy is everything nowadays. If we hit something, whether it be a fiber or, you know, a gas line, it can get expensive, you know, not to mention dangerous. So, you know, as time goes on, it's like computers. They advance. I haven't seen the guys use the one that we have currently because it just don't work. That's how outdated it is. So they do last. It's not like we're going to purchase this thing and in 5 years it's going to be outdated. This is a pretty good unit. Most of the units that are made today are all really close with the same technology they use, but some are better than others. And then the software that this one uses is software that everybody's using. You know, all the locators that are coming out from the different companies, whether it be USCI, like you had mentioned, or, you know, the phone company front, all of them, they all use this type of locator. So, you know, I think it's not only is it an investment, like Steve says, it's a tool to use, but we're going to be able to do much more than we've been able to do. So, you know, my goal in every city I've ever worked for is to be able to locate all the curb stops. It doesn't sound like it's a big thing, but when it's February and we have a water main break or service break and we got 18 inches of snow and there's snow banks that are 4 feet tall, to know where those things are at without sending one of my staff out at 2 a.m. to try to chisel through the snow to find it can be the difference between flooding somebody's basement and not. So it's just kind of an added security. And then it also, you know, it lays the foundation for gritting out our own fiber and our own utilities on our own property for future development. You know, like with the bottle shop, for example. I mean, we were delayed a week because we couldn't get somebody out there to do just what I'm talking about doing. So that's just a couple of examples.
Okay, and then the only other question, I guess, is as far as the capital improvement and everything, that's all kind of budgeted for or within the budget that you guys have?
Correct.
Okay. That's all.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Joe. I also want to mention, I talked to Darcy earlier today and she said budgets wise, it comes from two enterprise funds, the water fund and the wastewater fund, but it's money that they set aside for maintenance and additional tools like this. So it's there for it. But I know what the curb stops has, it's one thing if they run the tracer line correctly, but if they don't, then you have issues with it. And I think that this is going to come, this is going to pay for itself in the long run, because at $1,250 a shot, I can tell you, we're going to be having a lot more locates done. And then we'll spend more money than it will be to buy this tool. And that would be a shame to have to do that. So, all right, Rob, you have any comment on this?
I agree with you, Mr. Mayor. We want to spend money wisely, and I think this tool is going to help the city do some things that we otherwise have to contract out for. So I'm for it.
All right. Thanks, Rob. Kevin, your comments?
Yes, Mayor. Thanks. I have a couple questions. Licensing, do we have to pay any licensing for the software that we're using? Is there any annual fees affiliated with this piece of equipment?
So, good question. MnCore is the software that we use, and it's provided by MnDOT. So there is no cost to it. The only cost will be a data charge because it's hooked up through satellite for the GPS. So you're going to have a monthly Verizon bill that will go along with it for usage. I don't know what that total is, but you know, it's not going to be the amount that you would use on your phone, if that makes sense, because it's not something that you're going to be out running five hours per day. I mean, I shouldn't say that. I mean, this summer, if we get it and we have spare time to send out one of the sewer and water guys to locate curb stops 2 days a week, it comes with the unlimited plan. So it's not like you're searching Google or YouTube videos with it. It's just data to pick up the satellite signal.
Okay. Any updates that we'll be paying for down the road for this thing? Does it have any stuff from this, again, the MnCore provider, be paying for updates down the road?
So all the research that I've done, updates have, there's no charge to it. There's been minor updates. That's how good the system works. I'd be willing to bet that Craig, they probably got a Tremble, would be their GPS, which is the same thing that's in here. It's a pretty foolproof system. If there is software updates that do come out, typically it's just to, better the equipment. It doesn't necessarily mean that you have to do it for it to work. So we're not like we're tied into anything with them. The only thing we have to do is go in and sign up for it. That's it. So it's not like a license contract. It may be a license contract, but you're not tied in anything, if that makes sense.
Okay. How about calibration costs? Do the company you're purchasing us from, do they offer any calibration down the road, or does this thing need anything?
They calibrate, the GPS will calibrate itself.
Okay.
And the locator, you can send them in and have them, test them, but you can usually tell if they're not working. You're either on or you're off.
All right. And then lastly, training. Any training involved other than YouTube video or
training?
Training.
Another great question. To locate, to be a good locator, anybody can go out there and take a 5-minute course and kind of fumble through it. But to be really, really good at it, yes, there is training. It is free. And it's put on by Minnesota Rural Water, who also uses this unit. So there will be training available, and I will be sending guys, probably two guys at a time to go.
Okay. That's all I have. Very good, Jason. Good job. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Kevin. Those are two questions I asked earlier.
Yep, great question.
For the updates and stuff like that. So those are all good questions. Sarah, your comments?
My questions have been answered already. So I'm fine with that. Thanks.
All right. I think this tool will pay for itself in the long run. We'll be happy we have it. Craig, as Jason mentioned, do you have something like this for your business here at Hawkins Anderson? Do you have something like this?
Well, yeah, we use the Tremble equipment, but it's more survey type related, but similar technologies.
Okay.
So the Tremble is like, there's like a Tremble incorporated with this, but the survey software that they use is going to be the same as what we're using. So you can imagine that surveyors using this software to get, for surveying how accurate and close it has to be. It's the same concept.
Okay. And then question for Joe Coleman, our data plan is unlimited, right? I take it, I would think anyway.
Like our cell phone data plan or GPS data plan?
Well, if not, we may have to adjust that to unlimited.
So,
go ahead, Jason.
So we all have our own cell phones.
Yeah, we reimburse employees.
Yeah, Todd and I and Dave have a different type of plan for emergency stuff. I can look into that to see what it would be. Otherwise, we will get a government contract that's issued with this locator. So
all positive points. I mean, the updates are come with the product. No, it's a license, but not anything. And training is free in that. So I'd say it's a tool that we probably should have had years ago, but didn't. Another catch up for our council. Anyways, on that, do I have a motion to approve the purchase of the GPS locator by Utility Logic and the price of $10,459? Do I have a motion?
I'll make that motion, Mayor.
Councilor Robinson makes that motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Councilor Bauer makes a second. Any further discussion? If not, Diana, do a roll call, please.
Councilmember Edvig?
Aye.
Councilmember Bauer?
Aye.
Councilmember Muehlbauer?
Aye.
Councilmember Robinson?
Aye.
Mayor Feldman?
Aye. All right, and Jason said it would take 2 weeks to get it, so order it up. And hopefully won't have to have a need for it in that 2 weeks, hopefully. You know, I say, well, I hope so. Anyway, all right, moving on to new business item 9E, bottle shop full-time liquor store clerk. Joe?
Honorable Mayor and Council, this is another topic that we covered at the work session last Tuesday. Generally, I think the majority, if not all, members of Council present were in favor of moving forward with this position. I did provide some additional information since the work session that I had sent out to City Council. With that, staff's looking for authorization to post this position and advertise. The original proposal was at a grade 4 step 1, which nothing has been formally changed to at this point. So that's where it stands here tonight for discussion.
All right, so Joe, tell us the breakdown by the hour for that, so we understand what we listened to at the work session.
That is $22.56 per hour.
Okay. Well, I can tell you, we had a long discussion at that work session about this, and I don't know if that number will fly here. We're gonna go through a discussion here with council, of course, on that. We all got an email from Joe. I'm not gonna go into the email other than we have tabled the part-time issue on the liquor muni. We have tabled that. So this comes down to the liquor muni. We all know that the liquor muni is self-sustaining and pays for itself and the expenditures that it does, and it contributes $60,000 a year to the city. I don't like the fact, and I'm sure Kevin would agree with this, I don't like the fact where the state comes in here and gives us their recommendations in a strong way. I've never understood where, when it's good for them, they tell us how to run it, when it's not good for them, they tell us they don't want to be involved in it, whatever. It is our city to do what we choose to do for the right of our and the goodwill of our residents. I don't know if I believe in all the legalities of it all. Dave may be able to explain some of that to us here. I just know one thing. I know John Schmidt wouldn't say he needs a full-time if he didn't need a full-time. John doesn't come to us asking for things. You have to almost pry it out of him, which I've had to pry it out of a couple of talks I've had with him. But he has told me last week he needs a full-time person to count on. He has Crystal and himself. That's all he has. So how we choose to do this is up to us, but we should give him a full-time employee. He needs it. We should do it. Dave, can you tell us the legalities of this, why we're pushed to do it one way or the other, or do we have the flexibility to do it our way?
Mayor and members of the council, I think you're referring to the Minnesota Pay Equity Law. That's a report that is submitted by the city, I believe, once every 3 years. It's going to be looking at gender classification and the city's pay plan there. So the state will do some testing of the different positions and who is in those different positions, and then provide feedback to the city on that. And so there's always just a concern out there on what the potential effect of hiring decisions, pay scales, and then corresponding individuals that are occupying those positions, whether they be a male dominated class or a female dominated class. So there's a lot of moving parts on that. And that's why I think staff had the recommendation that it did. But the council can certainly discuss and provide feedback and ultimately decide on that. Again, any issue would come up when if it even does, would be something that would be addressed in the pay equity report that would be submitted to the state. And again, it wouldn't be just specific to this one position, it'd be looking at all positions in the city.
All right, well, before I pass it on for comment, I just have to say here that whether it's because he has a majority of women working for him, in my opinion, as far as my perspective, I didn't care if they offered it to a man. I didn't care who they offered it to. It was going to be a scale because I'm a firm believer. It doesn't matter what your gender is to me. Can you do the job? That's all I'm ever concerned about. Can you do the job? I don't care if you have long hair, short hair, no hair. I don't care as long as you can do the job. So to me, when it becomes this type of thing here, I don't know what the ramifications are. I'm going to ask you about that, Dave, here. But when we first talked about this at a work session, you know, I don't care who applies for the job. Once again, if it's male or female, that was what we were offering for this specific job. Okay. And that there was also something that I pointed out at discussed with Joe Coleman is that if this person gets hired, male or female, whichever, and does a great job, John could come forth and ask for an increase in their pay and come to the council about that if they're doing that good of a job at any time, say 6 months to a year down the road. He could come to us and say, this person is doing such a wonderful job. I think they should get an increase in pay and come forth to us and we could discuss at that time. That's always a flexibility with the council that we can do. So, you know, we're not asking for somebody to do something more for less. We're asking for equal pay here. And again, I don't think the council even thought about male, the gender of it. We thought about just what was a fair wage to put out there to get an applicant for the job. At least that's my take on it from the work session we had. So let me ask you, Dave, before I pass it on to council, what are the ramifications if we go lower, go with what we did in the work session, what would be the ramifications if it came out against from the state to us later on?
Mayor and members of the council, in regard to what the state is going to be looking at is the structure of the pay plan. And then it's going to be looking at whether the classes that are in there are either male or female dominated and see if there is any compliance issues. Now, if they were to flag something, they would come back to the city. And again, this is something that is submitted once every 3 years. And then the city would have the ability to take a look at that and then potentially make some type of remedial action. If the city did not do that, the state may potentially impose a fine upon the city, but the city has an appeal process that it could go through with that. So again, if something were to be found to be out of whack, that would be brought to the attention of the city, which could take a look at it and potentially modify things.
Okay. And one more thing before I get a discussion here again with council here, I want to mention something here. My concern is this. We have a full-time employee under John who has been there, I believe, 20 years and making a certain amount of salary. This amount here is equal or questionable to that, you know, at a level. And I wonder how she would feel if someone came in, new start, to the job that she took over 20 years to accomplish in her first 7 years that she's capped. So I bring that up in the sense that I would be concerned about that if I worked at a job a long time and found someone starting out at what it took me 20 years to get. So I just throw that out here. I am so against this gender thing once again, because I believe it's about the person. Can they do the job? Again, I don't care if it's a teenager, an adult, male, female, I don't care what they are. Can they do the job? I just think we get carried away with some of this stuff here. So I'm going to turn this over for comment here to Joe Muehlbauer first. Your comments, Joe?
Well, I have to agree with you as far as gender is irrelevant. Much like many other things are irrelevant, it's just whether or not the person's qualified to do the job. Unfortunately, I'm not happy with basically the work session that we had. We discussed possibly starting a little lower. I think giving it a female dominated position, we're going to end up creating more issues for the city, unfortunately, and if we do go forward at that lower number. I do also believe that we kind of went all in when we decided to do the expansion on a liquor store. And I think if we're going to do that, we need to provide John with the people he needs. I'm not real happy with the pay scale being what it is and having to deal with the extra gender stuff, but I do understand why it's there and whatnot as well. So it's kind of unfortunate, but at the same time, I guess fortunate as far as the other employee that has been there longer and this person starting close to what they're at, I guess I would think that the steps would be what the steps are And regardless, they're going to end up where they're going to end up either way. I mean, I can understand them being upset with that, but that's unfortunately kind of what position we're in. But for me, while I'm not happy with the end result of not being able to, in my opinion, not being able to go forward with it without creating more problems, I'm still in favor of giving him the help he needs.
All right. Thank you, Joe. All right. Let me pass this on to Sarah. Your comments.
Yeah, I mean, I too am in favor of giving him the help he needs. Like you said, Joe, he doesn't ask for a lot. John doesn't ask for a lot. So if he's saying he needs another full-time employee, then he needs another full-time employee. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to be at the work session, but Mayor Feldman did kind of catch me up to speed on kind of what was going on with that. I worry about the pay thing, because that is a very sensitive topic everywhere right now. I mean, you look at it and people who have been working at their jobs for 20, 25 years, they're watching new people come on the job and start darn close to where they're at. And it's really hard on them. It's hard on the morale at the job itself, because you have, you know, nurses and people who, you know, who worked for years to get where they are, and to have somebody walk in who just finished nursing school and start making that same amount of money is hard. It's hard to see. But I also want to make sure that we don't get ourselves in any kind of lawsuit type issue, and make sure that we're doing what we need to do. Following the steps sounds like, you know, Joel Coleman said he could try to draw something up or figure something out, but, you know, that's also kind of putting him in a position where, you know, he's got to try to make it look okay and, you know, justify something that maybe isn't quite okay. So, you know, I think a lot of jobs are already underpaid anyway. So that's just my own opinion, but I mean, I don't know what every job pays, but I know, that there are several jobs that I feel don't get paid nearly enough for what they do. I really want to get John this employee that he desperately needs. So I'm in favor of hiring somebody at this time.
Okay. Thank you, Sarah. I also want to mention one of the hard things that I've discussed this with Joe Coleman about this, of course, is the take that, you know, as council looks at this, I mean, there's para involved, there's insurance involved. It's just not the base pay that's involved. And it's hard for me, by the way, as I mentioned, and Joe Muehlbauer alluded to it, and Sarah has, that you have a long-term employee here and you see someone's, you know, just straight coming in, making that kind of money from the beginning. But that is the market today, I guess. And, you know, I always believe that you have to earn a little bit. You have to go through some training or experience before you get the upper end. But that's the way it is. That's the way it is. So, I'm being educated on this beyond my thinking anyways. But Kevin, I'll turn it over to you for your comments.
Yeah, I too, thank you, Mayor. I too am disappointed with the state meddling and what the city can and can't do in some cases. It should be none of their concern. It just helps them hold, securing their hold on wages and job classifications, which is really an overreach on their part. And I'm very disappointed to know that we have to follow some of this stuff. Again, I'm all for equity and, you know, equality. And again, we don't know. We could have six guys apply for this job and not one female. And I never thought about the ramifications with the way the step process is. The existing full-time person could be making more or even less than the new person coming in, however that might calculate it out. I think in the application process, I talked to Joe Coleman this afternoon. I personally think the six-month retail is kind of light in the experience portion of our request as far as qualifications. You're bringing somebody in like this I think they should have a little more than 6 months. I mean, somebody could wander over from Quick Trip or whatever, and not saying they're not qualified, but and maybe they are Quick Trip and they are qualified and they should come over, but at least a year worth of retail. I mean, this is customer service business. This is what they do. We want this business to be successful in every way, shape, and form. And I know John would use his ability as far as interviewing these people, but 6 months doesn't seem like very much to me. I guess also if we're all in for a penny, in for a pound, maybe we should discuss down the road, maybe doing away with part-time entirely and having nothing but full-time employees, if this is the way it has to be. And then that might even free up John's time even further or get some experience that we want. I don't know how the numbers all shake out, but for the record and for the public, you know, that $22.55 an hour or $56 an hour, on top of that, my major concern was a $7,000 para that the city pops into, as well as on the high end of $15,000 for healthcare. And everybody knows healthcare is the big buzz for the last 15 years. That's what it's all about. So another $22,000 on top of the $22.56, which was putting them at a little over 62 or 63,000. Now, again, also for the record, we're trading a part-time person allegedly for a full-time person. So we're taking away $25,000 part-time salary, and that reduces our overall cost to around $43,000, $45,000. So there is some trade there, but very disappointed the way the city can mandate what we, or the state can mandate what we can and can't do. But I have my utmost faith in John. Joe Coleman said he's talked to him extensively over the last couple of years, especially in the last couple of months with what's going on and how busy he's been. And the store is very busy. He never asked for anything. He's a quiet in demeanor, but he seems to be a very good marketeer. And I'd like to see it open up and give him the opportunity to do what we're paying him to do and what he wants to do. So moving forward, I guess I would go back to the original pay plan that Joe Coleman had laid out, or whatever we have to do to qualify without getting flags raised and getting in trouble, to go back to that original program. But I have the faith in John that it'll happen. He'll get the right people in there. And again, everybody's been paid to stay home. Let's face facts here, folks. Things aren't getting made, built, sent, shipped, processed. It's terrible. And they're offering $5,000 bonuses for people to cook at a golf course, for crying out loud. If you sign up, and then you can get a bonus at the end of, if you're there for a year or 6 months. But they should start paying the people $300 a week more that are already working, instead of paying the people that are sitting on their butts at home doing nothing, and then see how many people want to get a job after that. But I say let's move forward.
Thank you, Kevin. Before I turn over to Rob, you know, Joe Coleman, explain to us, you know, the responsibilities of a full-time position at the liquor muni, please.
Sure. So they're going to be under direction of the manager and assistant manager, but there may be times where they're in charge of the store when John and Crystal are not there. I'm sure they'll be provided lists and stay on top of inventory, helping load, unload, move inventory around the store, set up displays, run the cash register. I'm sure there'd be some level of light oversight of some of the part-time stuff, part-time workers that come in to assist. Since this position would be full time. So, I mean, it is a fairly basic job as far as the pointing and the job description go. I know we talked about my modifying it a little bit. There just really wasn't much to modify. So it kind of is what it is, but it's in that job description that was sent out.
Okay. Again, before I turn this over to Rob, I have a question for Dave here. You know, Dave, you know, they're talking about, I believe Kevin said $22.56 to start. So is it possible, and I say this at $20 an hour, you know, $41,600, is it possible to start this out at a $20 an hour job and then after 6 months probation period, raise it to the step without being crucified by the state? Is that possible that we could do something like that to make sure that the person we get is worth the money that, you know, that the step says we should pay? I mean, can we do something like that?
Mayor, members of the council, I think that you would be able to have some flexibility. Again, the report is submitted every 3 years. And I don't know exactly when the last report was sent, but that's when that's the snapshot that the state is going to take in looking at the again at the pay structure of the city's pay plan at the time that information is submitted.
Well, I'll let Kevin speak in a second, and Rob, of course, but I just want to say to you that I think that way you can make that long-term employee that's been there under John at least more acceptable in their minds as someone starting at equal to her after so many years that she's put in. This way you have something at least after 6 months you say, this person is qualified to get more because they are working hard, whatever. I mean, yeah, I'm the old school that you got to show me something before I shell out something. You know what I mean? I've earned everything I have, and I started from the bottom up. I never started the top down. So I'm that old school way of thinking, and I wish we were more in that way of thinking, to be honest with you. But anyway, Kevin, you have something to say before I turn over to Rob here?
Thank you, Mayor. Sorry about that. Yeah, Joe Coleman, background check and or drug test. These people are this applicant's eligible, or they have to fulfill those requirements?
I most likely do a background check. I don't know that we've done regular drug testing there. I know we do with Public Works to be Department of Transportation compliant. It's probably maybe something we could do. I guess I don't know. It's not something I looked into, though, on the drug testing.
Okay. All right. Rob, your comments?
Yeah, I just can't get there. I just don't understand the environment that we're in here and around St. Francis. If you go to any of the liquor stores, they're not even making close to a liquor store employee, full-time or not. Not even getting close to that. I'm for drawing the line in the sand and to have the state prove to me that somebody in St. Francis as a liquor store employee should be making $22.56 an hour. Our city employees should be making relative to what our constituents make. This is a very small city, comparable. I know county employees that I work for, they ain't even close to $22.50 an hour. And they're county employees that have a way bigger boatload of tasks and things that they have to accomplish on a daily basis. It just baffles me that the leadership in the city won't do a reclassification study and open their eyes and look to see what the cities around us are paying for minimal employees. You're going to bring somebody in to cut grass. We're going to call them a full-time employee. We got to start them at $22.50 because we're not willing to make them a grade one, step one. Where's grade one, step one? Where's grade two, three? We're at grade four already. This is where I just can't get on board with just constantly saying, well, the state gender this, that. It isn't about gender. It isn't about not accepting a full-time. I'm for a full-time employee, but I just can't get to $22.56. You have to look at the person that's there right now that's been there 20 years. They're already at step 10. So this person is going to start in and around exactly where they're at on step one. They're going to surpass that person. So that person is going to walk. I just don't understand that we can't grasp that understanding that we're paying St. Francis employees all the way across the board, administrative assistant starters to liquor store employees. We're just starting at an outrageous thing without sitting down and saying, hey, we need to reevaluate this point system thing that has us paying way more than what our constituents and residents around us are making per hour. I just can't get there, and I hate to, you know, throw John on the sword, but I just can't get there today. And I wish that the city council would see that we're paying a liquor store employee. The school doesn't pay EAs $12-13 an hour, and they're doing way more work than what a liquor store employee. They got way more responsibility for childcare than a liquor store employee. It's all about accounting for the liquor store. And you're putting kids' lives in educational assistance. And I don't even think school teachers start at $22.50 an hour. I just can't get there. And I'm sorry. I know this is going to pass because nobody wants to draw the line in the sand and say, you know what? The state isn't right here. Our point system for the city of St. Francis needs to be reevaluated. And at some point, we have to draw the line in the sand and say, we need to fix it. So that's where I stand. Sorry, I just can't pay somebody. And this is out to the residents, and I hope they all watch and come up into, you know, up in arms and join our meetings, because I don't think any of our residents are accepting of a liquor store employee making $22.56 an hour. I just don't see it, but let my phone ring and tell me that you're approving of it, and I'll change my mind, but I just can't do that today.
I think you got your point across, Rob. Okay, let me just say here, a couple things here, okay? John needs a full-time employee. That is the bottom line. Second of all, it is a self-sustaining enterprise situation, okay? So really right now is we have to decide on giving him a full-time employee, what we can do here. So my suggestion is this. We don't go by the step. We go through the 6-month probation period. We start this out at $19, which equals $39,520 a year, or 20 at $41,600 a year. We start out at a lower number, see what this person's like after 6 months. We may find out this person doesn't work and we cut the tie and move on to someone else. We find out this person excels and is worth the extra money, so we go that route. I'm all for a phase in. I'm all for, you know, giving some experience here, but we're in a situation here, Rob, where our back is to the wall. We have a manager who's managing an enterprise fund that contributes to the city of St. Francis and is our cash cow. So, you know, I understand everything you're saying. I have my doubts too, and like this, and the step situation and the interference from the state and everything else that goes with it. I get to the point where I just say enough is enough here. Just like with the Charter Commission, why does a 10th District Court judge decide who's on our Charter Commission when they know nothing about our city? That should be up to our city council, not a 10th District Court judge, but that's the way it is. So Kevin, you have one of the comments you want to make here?
I do. I just want to make one statement that, Rob, I understand your passion. I appreciate everything you were talking about. I held the same flag for a long time, but please don't cast aspersions that the rest of us are either spineless, gutless, or have no courage to go against the grain. You weigh the options. It's our opinion. We're allowed to have that opinion because it's America, but it doesn't mean we're any less a person or have the care of the city that you do. We made a decision on one side or the other. It has nothing to do with fear or, again, spinelessness or gutlessness or courage to do the right thing. We're weighing the options out, whether it's litigation by the state at some point, or this is one place I'm not going to plant my flag. You're welcome to do that, and I respect that wholeheartedly. But again, the second time in about 3 years you've said more or less rating the level of our, pride in what we're doing here or something. But again, I appreciate your opinion. I respect your opinion, and you need to respect ours as well without casting aspersions that we can't cut it. So that's all I got to say.
Thank you for that, Kevin. You know, I just, like I say again, he needs a full-time employee. That's what he needs. Okay, so how can we do this that works to our bent, can kind of compromise, because I believe in compromise in situations like this. I'm so sick of black and white and cut and dry type of things like this. So is it possible, Dave, that we could start this out at what we agree on is either $19 or $20 an hour job with the para and the insurance, which Joe has put at the high end, so that's not going to pan out to that. But I'm saying, is it possible we could start with that, go through a probation period, see where the evaluation of this individual is at the end of 6 months, and then see if we can raise it from that point and put it on track at that point. At least by then we may feel more comfortable with the way it's worked out. I know, let me, Joe, before I get to you, let Dave say something here. I'll give it to Joe here. Dave, please tell us.
Mayor and members of the council has the final decision on this. If there's an issue in the future, we will address it then.
All right, thank you, Dave. Joe, go ahead with your comments.
I was just thinking too, I mean, we do have some flexibility, and I think in the at the end of the day, we're going to end up, let's say this person stays with us for 10 years, they're going to end up at the max pay based on the step system anyway. So if we start with the first 6 months, say at 18, which is, I believe, the number we kind of settled at in the work session, if we start at 18 for the first 6 months, possibly go up to 19 after that for the next 6 months, and then I don't know when the step process would necessarily start. I guess I don't, I understand where Coleman gets the step process from and from the state and whatnot. I guess I don't understand how the grades go, if it starts at grade one or if it starts at grade four up to grade one or wherever it goes. But I mean, to start a full-time employee, if it says you have to start them at grade four based on this equal whatever it is, I mean, then it is what it is. It's, again, unfortunate I disagree with that, but I think us having that flexibility of starting at 18 for the first six, get past that, and we bump it up to 19, and then say after a year they can start at the 22 at that point. And while I don't agree necessarily with the pay, and I do agree with Rob as far as, I mean, I'm baffled that a liquor store employee would make that much, but at the same time, giving it's a city job and it is self-sustaining, I think that we, in my opinion, by going forward with the expansion, we kind of committed to going all in with this project and trying to make it successful one way or another. I don't agree necessarily with the 22, but again, that's what the state says. That's what we're kind of linked to. And as I disagree with it, I still understand it, but I think with the flexibility, we start at that 18 and maybe work our way up to where it is within the step process. I don't see an issue with that after a year. I mean, there's a lot of companies now in my field, in HVAC, doing a year of probationary period, which I think is kind of insane myself, but that's kind of what's out there right now. So just throwing that out there as an idea to the council. I mean, starting lower and working our way up within the first year. And after that year, if they're on the step process, the state can't really complain to us. I mean, again, I don't know when the last deal was either. I don't have that information in front of me either. I mean, it could be within 2 months and then here we are, you know. So just my thoughts. I don't know. I'd like to hear what people think about that.
All right. Thank you, Joe. You know, one comment I would make on that is that, you know, we talked about the 18, but Joe Coleman's concern was, are we going to get any applicants at that amount the way the market is? So I'm wondering, you know, and I like what your thought is. So I'm just wondering if we shouldn't do it like start at 19, bump to 20, and then go step after a year, because that way you start at 39,520, which you may get more applicants, may get more, you know, appealing to get the job or want the job versus the 37,440. Because people are not going to look, they'll look at the parent, they look at the insurance, but they're going to look at their base pay too, by the way. So I'm just wondering, I like your concept on that. I'm just wondering if we shouldn't go from 19 to 20 instead of 18, 19, and then 20 up to the step in that. And that would get a more audience, more applicants in there of a quality, of a better quality. I'm thinking like that anyways. That's just my thought on that. So what do you think about that, Joe? So.
I mean, I wouldn't necessarily be opposed to it. I think starting lower is better in general to start at, especially. Rob, I don't know. I think at the work session, you brought up some numbers of averages. I don't know if you still have that information or what does an average liquor store employee full-time make? Or do you remember what those numbers are? Do you have that information?
It was 16 to 18. And I think, you know, making $18 an hour full-time, you're going to get some of those employees from Oak Grove and over those liquor stores that are paying less, even some of their good part-timers from those liquor stores that are going to come, you know, attempt to come over and, you know, make that. And I, you know, like I said, in the work session, I can get to 18. Just because where the market is right now, like I said, there's county employees that are making $16, $17 an hour. And to say that the county is somehow shielded by the state of not having to pay this starting wage of everyone in the county at $22.56, to me is asinine. I can get to 18. We can, that'll give us some time to sit down and reevaluate this point system, get some information from the state, use an outside agency that's not locked into the city to do a job classification study on all of our employees based on our demographic and regional location, and really start fresh. Like I said, to start at step one, and somebody else that's been here for 20 years is already at step 10 and they're at the exact same pay, you're not going to give that person another 10 steps to go to the new top salary. That person is going to long shoot them by $5, $6, $7. So why wouldn't that person just quit and try to get rehired again? I mean, we've had this conversation in the county year after year after year, you know, why wouldn't people just quit and then start again? That way they can get that $22.56 an hour. It's just, it's common sense. I can get to the 18. I know John needs a full-time employee. I want to give him that employee, but I want to be committed to a reclassification and a job study here in St. Francis. That's where I'm at.
Thanks, Rob. Joe Coleman, you have something to say?
I feel like I need to clear the record here. The assistant liquor store manager at the top end makes $5 an hour more than the top end of this job. So that is not an accurate statement. Second of all, I'd be more than happy to get some quotes on a full compensation study for all city employees.
Right, but that's down the road. We need to hire someone now for John, okay? So that's what we're at right here today. I mean, that's all.
Well, that's why I kind of called on Rob, too, is because I wanted to know. I know, I remember he brought the information to the work session, and I did not have that ready. So that's why I wanted to kind of chime in with him. But I think if the top is close to 18, I think if we put it out there at 18, see if we get applicants, there's nothing wrong with that. If we're having trouble then we can discuss, you know, hey, maybe we need to do it a little bit more, 1850, 19, maybe, to get people in here and start there. I just think throwing it out there, you know, around that top pay, you start at the top pay or even just a little bit less, you're not losing much and you're looking at that higher end for the potential of that job. I mean, I took a job for a couple bucks less than what I could get, just because it was more convenient at the time for me, and able to work, you know, work with it. I'm losing technically $6,000 a year or so. But I was willing to make that sacrifice in order to make things work, you know? So I think looking at those things, I think starting at 18 would be good. That's just my opinion. But like I say, I'd like to hear what the rest of council has to say too.
All right. Let me just say this to you. I did talk to John last week about that after that work session, and he was fine with the 18. He was just more important, into getting some help is what he needs. Okay. So at this particular point here, because we could quabble about this all night and we talked about it already a lot. So I tell you what, I have no problem with the suggestion that Joe Muehlbauer just brought up. I say start at 18, 6 months later, go to 19. And then at the year mark, go to the steps and be done with it, if that's where it works. Okay. My only concern is, are we going to get applicants in 18? But I guess we won't know until we try. Dave, you don't know when the last state, report was, do you?
I do not. I'd have to defer to staff on that.
Joe, do you know that, Coleman?
He is the one who files it. I think she said she thought it would be next year that it has to be filed.
Next year?
That's what she thought.
Okay. So it's next year and we hire now, we'd be at the step mark in the year. So the state would be satisfied and we'd start out and we'd be satisfied. Kind of like a compromise. That kind of works all right in my mind. You know what I mean? We start out at 18, 6 months later, we go to 19. And then by the end of the year, we go to the full steps so that by the time the state comes in a report date, tell me if I'm wrong, then the state would see that we're at the steps and we're fine. Correct or not? Possible? Dave?
Mayor, that would be a determination of the state and we would certainly work with them if they would have any issue. and bring that to a council's attention.
All right. So let me just, I'm going to turn this over one time around here. I don't want to keep going on about this issue because I know it's self-sustaining. And I know he needs somebody, but I do agree with what Rob is saying and an issue I brought up in the very beginning about that full-time employee. To have someone come in and start where their person is. I mean, Joe, you're telling me that that's not true, that person is making more than that start at that step. Tell me, please.
The assistant liquor store manager is at $33.54 an hour.
So where do we get the fact that we're told differently from John on that?
I don't know. I don't know where that came from. I've never heard that before personally.
So you're telling me that she makes $33.50 an hour? That's besides para, that's her hourly wage.
Correct.
Okay. Well, that sure is different than what John said. Okay. Okie doke. Okay. So, all right, Kevin, I'm going to ask you quickly here. Do you have any problem with the step up in 6 months to a year and go to the full step at the end of the year? Do you have any problem with that? Or would you like to start at 19, go to 20 instead and then go to steps? Or what would you like?
No, that was kind of my thought. I brought up the glass door information last week, also indeed.com last week about liquor store employees. Again, I'd rather pay part-time people more money, but I just was trying to avoid any litigation down the road. Again, with the revelations of what Joe Coleman and our city attorney has brought to our attention. So whatever's going to work. Just because we make money doesn't mean we have to spend money. And like I said, we're very lucky and blessed to even have a revenue stream where most cities just have your tax money coming in. So whatever is going to work and keep us out of the hot water. I totally disagree with the state situation, having mandated, having the overreach of what they do. So whatever's going to work and keep us out of trouble and get John what he needs to get going. Thank you.
Okay. Sarah, your comments?
I am going to second what Kevin said.
That helps me a lot. Yeah. All right. Dave, legally, tell us what you'd recommend here. Please tell us what you'd recommend on the legal side of it.
Honorable Mayor, members of the council, can make the decision on what they want to do. This information will get submitted to the state. If there's an issue and they flag that, we're going to notify the council and work towards a solution on it.
Okay, so the question I have for you then is if we do it this way and the state were to come back and say, that's not right, you have to go to steps, and we remediate it by right away go to steps, is it a done issue then? Or
that would fix the issue. Okay. And that's what the state would do is, the first thing that they're gonna do is come up with a recommended course of action and work with the city to try to implement that.
Okay.
Prior to taking, the more punitive measure.
Okay. And potential back pay, Mayor.
One other question I have for you, Dave, is this. Would there be back pay involved or just the remediated going from that wage up to steps and correct it that way? And that's fine? Or is it a back pay situation too?
Again, that's going to be up to what the state is going to try to bring to the city and recommend and or potentially enforce.
Kevin, you have any comment on that? No. Okay. Joe, your comments? Okay. Rob, your comments, we already know what you feel. Okay.
Yeah, I can get there at 18. If the state says immediately, hey, you got to be here, then we go there. But right now, we draw the line in the sand, and if I have to rub the line out to go to 22.50, I'd really like to know what grade one, step one, starting salary looks like, and being able to, like we said, not really water down a job description, but we do have, a position profile, and whether that is $18 an hour at grade one, step one, and we assign it that way. I don't know. I don't know what the other three grades look like that are grade one, two, and three step ones. So I'd be okay with start at 18, go to 19. For now, get him an employee.
All right. Well, here's what I'm going to recommend here. I understand where you're coming from, and I almost agree with it. But to be safe than sorry, and more on the caution side, I would recommend we start at 19, go to 20, and then at the end of it, go to the full 2256. Okay. That way, the state says that we're not being cheap, we're not being whatever. We're looking at the market and phasing them in. It's only a dollar matter. It brings it from 37,440 up to 39,520 to start. I think that's going to be a better audience to apply to capture to get the job filled. But I think that if you go too low, you might really set up some red flags here, and I don't really want to do that. But if it's a year out, I look at the 19-20 and then a full step at the end of the year, I don't think the state's going to have much room to say anything about the full step at the end of the year. So to me, I don't want to quabble over a dollar an hour, man. I mean, it's just not worth it because we put more time into it than it's worth it. But I just don't want to go too low and have the states, you know, get recognition in a negative way from the state. I hate the state being on our shoulder. I hate that monkey on our back. I really do. But it's the way it is and what we have to live with right now. So I would recommend and entertain a motion that we hire a full-time employee at the liquor, at the bottle shop. We start out at $19 for 6 months, go to 20 at the end of 1 year. Start out at 19, after 6 months, go to 20. And at the end of the year, we go to the full step at 2256. Once we find out where this person, how they work and their experience and what they bring to the job. Do I have a motion to accept that? A motion on that at all?
I'll make that motion, Mr. Mayor.
All right, Councilmember Udvik makes that motion. Do I have a second? All right, I'll second it. Okay, any further discussion? I think we've discussed this enough. We'll go to a vote. Roll call, Diana, please.
Councilmember Udvik?
Aye.
Councilmember Bauer?
Aye.
Councilmember Muehlbauer?
Aye.
Councilmember Robinson?
Reluctantly, aye.
Mayor Feldman?
Aye.
Okay, so Jill, 19 is start, 6 months later, 20. At the end of the year, full scale. All right? Jill?
Yep.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Council. So it's been a long time discussion here, and I appreciate everybody's input to it. It's one thing governing and having your hand tied behind the back on issues at certain times of it. I really find that frustrating at myself and all that. It's just something we have to deal with and do the best we can, which is what I think we've done. So thank you very much for that. Okay, moving on. Meeting open to the public show. Do we have anybody second round here?
I do not see anyone that's not part of our team here.
Okay. Reports, administrator report, verbal update.
Honorable Mayor and Council, I just want to let you know that I did meet with MnDOT. Kate and myself met with Melissa Barnes and her engineer, Jennifer Wilkin. We were approved to use WSB as the consulting engineer, which was the city's preference. The list of engineers that we were provided from MnDOT for the project, we weren't familiar with. We do have somewhat of a familiarity with WSB. And they did work on the roundabouts towards the high school as part of that project too. So they have some familiarity with the city of St. Francis, but that was approved to use them as the contractor. And that was our preference, our staff's preference going into the discussions with MnDOT. So now the next steps will be to have staff from MnDOT and staff from the city of St. Francis meet with WSB, iron out some of the scope of work details, and then start moving the Highway 47 project forward.
Is that it, Joe?
Yeah.
Okay. And just for council's knowledge on this, or so that you know where I'm coming from, I told Joe, and I've also talked to Kate about this, and I've mentioned this at I think the work session or other meetings. The criteria should be based on three things. Safety, of course, is our number one priority. Number two, access to our existing businesses. And number three, expansion of our commercial base. I think if we have our consultants go off of that criteria, we may actually get a workable plan from what MnDOT thinks we should have to what we know we should have. I'm concerned about two roundabouts, the one at Pedersen and 233rd, because if they put roundabouts in there, we will lose the 150-foot of frontage road for future expansion. That concerns me. And I look at access to our businesses. as important. We don't want to end up with a ghost town in our town. That would be a bad thing for us. So we have to show that we support our businesses, which we do. So I'm looking at those three criteria. And I just mentioned this to council in general. Once again, safety, access to our existing businesses, and expansion of our commercial base is three things that I think are really important. Can I get a nod from everybody on that, that you agree with that or you don't agree with that? And then we can open it up for discussion. Do you agree with that, everybody? Pretty much? Okay, so that's just something, Joe, I would like you to at least bring to the attention of WSB as they start the consulting planning and that. And because I know that at the end of the day, MnDOT's going to listen to them very carefully. We have one shot at this and we got to do it right. Because if we wait too long, as I mentioned, I talked to our Kate today, if we wait, this goes on for a couple more years, they're planning a overlay in 2025. They're going to, once it gets to a bid process on that overlay, we're done. We're screwed. It's going to be, am I right on that, Kate? To get out to a bid process. So we don't want to let it go that far. We need to get this thing going. And I'm just glad that the commissioner opened up that we that they'll pay for this consultant. We never had that before, by the way, if you recall, in the whole year that we dealt with them with post-its on maps and multiple meetings, no one ever talked about a consultant. You know, it took us over a year to figure out we could actually do that. So that actual meeting that we did with Sarah, myself there and staff, got that out of the commissioner and she brought that up. And I think it's might work to our benefit. So let's hope so anyway. Hope is a good thing. Anyway, all right, thank you, Joe. Moving on to Public Works, there are monthly streets and parks and water and sewer reports. Jason?
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, before you have my standard Public Works report, I'll just add that now that I'm getting that GPS locator, we'll be able to complete our culvert inventory for the watershed. We have to take invert elevations in certain culverts that they point out, so I'll be able to get that done. That culvert inventory is kind of the last piece the city has to do to comply with the watershed, and that's in 2022. But we want to make sure that we have that done well before then. Our emergency response plan that WSB did, that is done. It's been approved. And it should, I believe, next week it goes active, actually goes into play. So that's another big thing crossed off the list. Crack fill and seal coating will be starting, I believe, next week. Depends if Pearson's can finish up with the job, or not Pearson's, but Ally can finish up with the job. They'll get the crack filling done first, and then Pearson's will come in and do the seal coating. And then the bottle shop, I've been spending quite a bit of time up there, myself, the mayor, just making sure things are going good. If they're not, we're making corrections. So I'll continue to do so until we feel comfortable and we can start seeing some sticks go up. So other than that, I'm happy to answer any questions you guys may have.
All right, thank you, Jason. One question, I did not see any lift stations on this report. There was nothing there. Is this a first for us or I'm hoping?
Well, just a lot of maintenance. We kind of ramped up our maintenance on the lift stations. We have an old fire truck that we can use as a water truck, whether it be water in the roads, whether it be flooding a rink. We also use that to jet out our lift stations and break down the solids and any larger material that could get caught in a pump. So we've ramped that up and it seems to be helping. It's not 100% foolproof, but we are starting to see some positive results by doing that.
No, that's very good. And then also I see the meter rereads are becoming more in line now that our system is working better. So, and that all the meters have been replaced, correct?
Correct.
Okay, good. All right. Very good report. Kevin, I'll ask you for your comments on his report.
I have nothing to add. Good report, Jason. Very thorough. Appreciate it. Also, thanks for paying some attention to our wonderful St. Francis entrance sign on the Round Lake Boulevard. And nothing makes me happier to know that when the wonderful council people of Little Grove are concerned about grooming aspects, St. Francis is on top of it. And that sign is very prominent. So thank you very much.
Yeah, now if we could just get them to clean up that house there that's close, we'll be good.
Well, don't ask for more than you can get. All right, Sarah, your comments?
Nope, good report, Jason. It's good to see our guys out working, and it's fun to stop and chat with them and get more education on what they're doing. They're always very friendly and happy to explain what they're doing and how things work. And I'm really appreciative of that, because I don't know a whole lot about lift station. So, you know, if they're out there and I have time and I can stop by and say, hey, how's it going? What you doing? They're always very, very willing to take a few minutes to talk and just say, hey, this is what we're doing. This is, you know, we do this how often, and, you know, kind of explain things. So I think that's awesome. Thanks.
Good to hear. Thank you.
All right. Joe, your comments?
Good report as usual, Jason. I don't have any questions, but thank you.
Okay, Rob, your comments?
Good report, Jason. Can we use any of that reclaimed water to flush those pumps out, things around the sewer station? That's basically going to break up those solids and put that water basically back into the system. Can we use any of that reclaimed water?
Yeah, we call it
types of tasks, and I know.
Yeah, our reuse water, we do actually use it for that, and we can also use it to put on the gravel roads, and then we irrigate the grounds with it as well. So we use as much as we can. Perfect.
Sweet. Did you say that you use it for the ice rinks too, flooding the ice rinks, or no?
No.
We can't get there yet.
We probably could. I just don't know how that public perception that may raise some flags. Right. I haven't been here long enough to throw that pot yet.
Yeah, I don't know. I think I read somewhere in California they're actually running their reclaimed water back into their water treatment facility.
They're actually doing that here in Minnesota.
Is that a puck or a biscuit?
Right.
Yeah, you know, I wish we could get there, because I think with all the state regulated, you know, on the reclaimed water, and looking at our numbers on the reports, that water's cleaner in my understanding. That water's cleaner than the well water that's brought into the original water treatment facility plant as is. Is that a fair statement, Jason?
Yeah, I mean, if you go by the numbers, it is. And there actually is a couple cities that are pumping it back into the system to use it. I mean, the ground is your best filtration system, so it's only going to get better. But like I said, I think we're a ways away from there. You know, our focus is just to keep getting the users up, and, you know, Kate's obviously doing a hell of a job doing that. So I think we're sitting pretty good.
Well, thanks for the report, Jason. Thanks for blowing Kate's head up. You do a great job too, Kate.
That's what's bringing forward. You can't keep up.
That's it. Thanks.
You know what we could do is just not tell the public and go ahead and do the water.
No, thanks.
We said we'd be fully transparent and honest. We can't do that. But, you know, I mean, seriously, we the water reclaimed is clean. We're putting the Sealy Brook was cleaner than it's in the Sealy Brook.
No question.
I mean, there's
the fecal count in White Bear Lake is, last I heard, was over 400. You have to be under 200 parts per million of fecal to be able to irrigate and spread it on fields. We're way below that.
What are we at? What are we at? You know,
okay. I don't know what the current numbers are, but I mean, it's tenths. You literally could drink it if you wanted to.
Well, I'm still actually waiting for Parrish and Rob to do that myself.
Well, according to Parrish, he never said he was going to. He just said Rob was. So maybe
I can get Jason to bring us a glass in.
Oh boy.
Okay.
No.
Thank you, Jason. Hold on. Rob keeps saying us. Who's us? Because as long as I know, Rob was the only one that said he would drink it. He keeps saying us, like the council is somehow.
I need a partner.
No, thank you.
I'll mention it to Parrish in the morning.
All right.
You know, he is a Class A holder. He probably should be the second one. I'll run that by him and see what he says.
Okie dokie.
Nothing says that you trust the water more than to give it a shot. All the numbers lead to clean water. So bring a glass in and we'll give it a shot.
Well, you know what's funny, Rob? You won't give, it, give it a shot, but you'll drink the water.
Sorry, sir. I'll give it a shot.
You know, like I said, you won't get a vaccine, but you'll drink the water. Okay.
That's right.
I'll see
right.
it.
That's right.
All right. Let's move on to. Go ahead, Rob.
I grew up on well water without a filter for many, many years. So I know well water is not the cleanest, but anything that goes through our wastewater treatment facility and looking at the numbers, that reclaimed water is really clean.
I would totally agree with that. Totally. All right, let's move on to council member reports. Okay, Sarah, let's start with you.
All right, well, last Monday, I attended the school board meeting, as did Kevin. He was there for a while. I also did join in on the planning and zoning meeting last week, just to see what was going on there. It was a pretty straightforward meeting, but I hadn't been to one for a while, so I popped in on that. I kind of am just raising my hands and giving up with the school district. I mean, I don't know how much worse they can screw things up. I really just don't. I mean, I hate to be that way, but they're making one poor decision after another, after another, after another. And they're not doing their research. They're having a work session right now, in fact, on this whole critical race theory, even though they will not call that it's very much leading to that. I feel like I guess it's in their court. If they decide to move forward this, their problems are just beginning, because there will be several people who pull their kids from the school. I don't think they have a good understanding. I hate to be the bearer of bad news to the district, but you can't have a bunch of white females trying to fix the problems of Black males. That doesn't work, because we don't know what their life is like. We can't represent them fully. We need them to do that. And unfortunately, Nate Chapman, who was on the committee, has left our district. He moved on to Isanti. They did live in St. Francis for, I think, 5 or 6 years, but they did open enroll their daughter in a different district, just because they did not care for St. Francis School District. So they are having a work session tonight. Liz has been kind of updating me a little bit, and it doesn't sound like it's going the best. I feel like I'm banging my head against a wall. They've had a lot of time to do some research on this critical race theory, and it's very obvious that they just aren't. They aren't really doing their homework on it. And that's really disappointing to me, because I feel like, for the most part, council, when we have a pretty big issue that we know that the community cares a lot about, we each do put in quite a bit of time researching and listening to people. So I'm a little frustrated with that. I do want to just, I was not able to make it to the chamber event, but I did hear that it was well attended, at least for most of the day. I think in the evening, some of the attendance dropped, but it sounded like people enjoyed it and are looking forward to the National Night Out or Night to Unite, where the chamber is also going to be doing a circus and little things like that. So I think that'll be fun. I did actually re-injure myself twice. I did it on Memorial Day weekend, and then I knocked my head again really good last night. So I saw my concussion specialist, and he's advising me to slow down a lot. So I'm going to be taking it easy for a little while and trying to let my brain heal before it won't heal anymore. So I'm gonna do my best to make it to all the council meetings. But if I'm having a really bad day, please understand that I may not be able to make it. I will keep you all updated if I won't be at a meeting, but my vision has decreased a lot just in the last week. So they're concerned about that. So I have to be very careful right now. So that's where I'm at.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Sarah. And I talked to Sarah earlier today, and we'll work with you, whatever we have to do to maintain you on the council. As far as the being a liaison of the school district, do not hit your head against the wall. Take a long, long break. Do not hit your head against the wall with them. I mean, it is frustrating. That's like taking a shower with the raincoat on and never getting wet dealing with them. So we'll just let the chips fall and see where it goes. They have to learn to grow up and start governing, and they'll have to do that on their own, okay? You can take them to trough, doesn't mean you can make them drink. I don't even think so far we haven't even been able to get them to trough. So let you take care of yourself, and we'll deal with you the best we can through meetings. If you can't get to a meeting, let us know and we'll fill you in the best we can, okay? All right. Kevin, your comments?
Thank you, Mayor. Yep, I also attended the work session last week. It was a 3-hour rigorous session full of healthy debate and discussion. Just to reiterate to the public, we work behind the scenes, even though you don't think we're out there, we're out there. And it is recorded for posterity's sake, for whatever that's worth. I also attended the school board meeting. I was there for almost 2 hours. I had to sit far back in the hallway. The audio portion of that was pretty tough in there. I was very proud to see a ton of people show up, something they were passionate about, and some good speakers. It was interesting to see Education Minnesota. One of their representatives was there, and I didn't get to hear what he said. I read something a little bit about after the fact, but just good to see, again, healthy debate, people coming out, something that matters to them. They come out to make a statement, so that was good to see. Planning and zoning meeting, again, welcome to a newer member that we have. Kate does a good job of herding us feral cats, whether it's a busy night or a so-so night. She warned them ahead of time next month is gonna be very busy, so hopefully we have everyone in attendance to make it happen. And Beth does a good job as well, getting things in order and process. So other than that, that's really all I have for the time being.
All right, thank you, Kevin. Rob, your comments?
Yeah, I went out on the weekend, enjoyed the festivities at the park, watched the softball tournament a little bit, had some barbecue sandwiches. It was well received for, you know, last minute. I hope to not see Pioneer Days fizzle to the, you know, because of COVID, but I'm hoping it'll be full-fledged next year. I live in the city. I wish the school district would get dissolved into another school district. That's just my personal opinion. So that all my constituents know where I stand. about the school district. They haven't tried to fix their fail enrollment and how to make that better. You're not going to get more dollars unless you fix your failing enrollment. It's a money-based thing based on children. So if all the children are open enrolling in other school districts, someone has to step in and say, this school district has another school district that's doing it. That's kind of where I stand on the school district. I've quit trying to go and be a voice of reason with them because they want to hear it. So they know better, and hopefully the voters will get out there, the school board, vote and vote some people in there that want to do the right thing. That's always our constituents is see the paint on the wall and, vote your conscience. So if we need to do a better job on the school district, then vote them out. So other than that, apologies for being late. I took today off, and all day today, I thought it was Sunday. My apologies. I'm like, I got to go to work tomorrow. It's Monday. And thanks, Joe Mielbauer, for asking that question, or I would have not. Twice. I've been sitting here waiting for you guys to show up tomorrow.
Okay. Is that it, Rob?
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
That's it for me, yes.
Okay. Joe, your comments?
I don't have much to report. I didn't make it to that community day thing. I kind of wanted to, but I've been busy working. If you count the council, three jobs. So I can afford my own security. Sorry, I had to say it. All right. But yeah, I don't really have anything to report.
Okay, thank you. All right. A couple of things I want to bring up here. On the 11th of June, on a Friday, I went out to the ambassador program out at the Anoka County Fairgrounds. Those girls do a tremendous job. I looked at two booklets full of pictures of events that they attend representing our city, and I could tell you they had Ambassador Queens from Princeton there, from Hopkins there, from St. Louis Park there. It becomes a friendship, a camaraderie between everyone, but they represent us really well. So I can't commend the job that Jackie is doing, Jackie Goodell is doing for them. She's done a great job, and they put a nice affair on. They were at the band shell there and a couple hours. But I just, if you ever took the time here to look at what they do, the things like Kevin says about how residents of the city don't know what we do in the background, they do a lot in the front foreground for us, representing us very well. And they're very much respected with all the other queens from all the other cities. They were, again, from Blaine, Princeton, Hopkins, St. Louis Park, Zimmerman. They had queens all over come for this affair. Really well done here. I commend Malcolm Beck. He's the president of it. He's done really well there. But Jackie's been that person out in the front, and she's done excellent with the girls. Something that, like I say, you should be very proud of, because they bring a pride to the city and really represent us well. So I love going to it. I like being part of it, and I was thrilled to be there. So also I want to bring up there in the off-week memo, in case you didn't see it, on page 5 there, it says the fire department was awarded a $2,500 no match grant from CenterPoint Energy. Funds were utilized to purchase a new thermal imager. I have to commend Dave and Joe for the ability to get out there and seek those grants like he does. And he does an excellent job at that. So kudos to you, Dave. Also, I saw that the fire went out on Saturday, and you also got permission to do the garage, which I was surprised. They wanted to let you take the shed down from the flows, but to let you take the garage down from the house, whatever. But I thought that was a very good there. So once again, on the grants, wherever you can find money like that and you're looking for it and all that, and you're getting it, that's really something to be looked up for and be appreciative. But thank you for that. Also, I did talk to Dave. He mentioned to me that that lady that came forth to council during the wintertime with that wood fence, she has built a new fence. He wasn't able to see behind it to see if she took the old one down, but she did put up a new fence that she said she would. So I just want to bring that to council's attention. Kevin and me will be at a finance committee meeting on Monday the 28th. It will be talking about community development. We'll bring their budget to us at that meeting. These decisions we make are hard decisions, and we have to look at the bigger picture of what's best for the residents we serve. It is frustrating at times when the state gets involved where they do, but I think as a council and staff, we work pretty good around those the best that we can. We do what we can within the power that we have, and we always want to make sure that we're covering the rear of our citizens and residents as we do. But we have fruitful work sessions and we have fruitful city council meetings. And on that, I can only say to you, thank you for the work that you do here. I know we don't get complimented a lot as far as that, but I do appreciate every one of my staff members, of our staff members, as I do our council members for the hard work. Whether we agree to disagree, we always will, but we can talk to each other, and that's a big deal. I mean, at the end of the day, we are still working as a council, as a solid unified body, and same with the staff and that. And again, we're not gonna agree on every issue, as we didn't agree with planning and zoning on one issue when it came to the crops on that 10 acres off of 47. We didn't agree, but we listened to their side of it and then we put our side out. That's what we do. That's called governing, it's called working. I wish that we could spread that, put that in a jar and give it to every one of the 7 board members on the school district, as well as Oak Grove. I wish we could, because there's JPAs out there, regionalization of utilities, so many things we could do in harmony together to benefit the residents on all sides. But I guess we'll just have to go by what hard work we've done in 4.5 years and the more hard work we have to do down the next years to come. But we have done really well here in the last 4.5 years, and I'm proud of my staff, our staff, I'm proud of our council, I'm proud of everybody working together, and I truly believe that the city is starting to see that too, by the way. We have kept to the platform we put out 4.5 years ago with being transparent and open and doing our due diligence. We've done all that and we continue to do that. And again, I can't commend our staff and our council enough on that, because it makes me proud to be a mayor of a town that I can look back in my corner and know that I have a full amount of support on everything here. For the health issues that Sarah and myself are going through, I thank the staff and council and the public for supporting us through the times that we're going through. I don't wish it upon anybody of what her and me are going through, but we are dealing with it, and it always helps to have support. Have our families are behind us, but having our staff and council and city behind us really makes my job, and I know Sarah's job, a lot easier in the long run. It's nice to know that we're being supported. I can't say that enough good words on that, because at the end of the day, when I first brought up about my cancer and held it back, it was hard to lie and to hold something back for me, because I like telling the truth all the time. But now being able to deal with it openly is nice. And I thank you for that very much. And I thank you for continuing with the Zoom meetings as we go through these health issues. On that, Joe, do we have any more business that we have to handle? Okay. Once again, I want to say thank you for all your work that you do, all the hard work you've done, and all the hard work you're going to do. And I want you to be safe. And any concerns you have, I only say this out to everybody, like I've told John this recently, you need to tell us what you believe, not tell us what we want to hear. Tell us the truth. Let us deal with it, and we'll deal with it the best we can. But we don't, telling us what we want to hear doesn't get things solved. Just tell us what's the truth. As I told John, once again, you want a full-time person, you need to tell us you want a full-time person, not sugarcoat it. Okay, that way we can discuss it openly and get it to a solution. So once again, thanks everybody. Keep safe, keep that good hard work up. And if I don't talk to you beforehand, the 4th of July, have a wonderful holiday and keep safe on that, okay? Thank you for everybody.
Good night, everybody.
I will adjourn this meeting on Monday the 21st at 8:04 in the evening. Thank you, everybody.